Lord, today we meet for the purpose of worship and for the blessing of your guidance. Rejoice with us as we prepare our hearts and spirits for the message you have inspired. Be with us as we grieve the passing of another of our fellowship. And celebrate with us the hope and promise of eternal life and love. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning. Very, very glad that you are here in the house of the Lord to worship with us at First Baptist Church this morning. And we want to, in just a moment, we're going to take just a minute to greet each other in person. Want to point out to you before we do that there are some cards in the pews in front of you, and want to invite you, especially if you're a guest, but invite you, even if you're here every Sunday, to look at that card, fill it out. Fill out as much of it as you want and leave as much blank as you want, but let us know something about you in particular if there's a prayer concern or anything else that you'd like to know or you'd like for us to know. And now, as is our tradition, would you just turn to each other and greet each other and pass the love of Christ.
Thank you. Let's pray. Precious God, we come this morning to worship and praise you. We come as your servants who have been given much and from whom much is expected. You have blessed us and have asked us to be good stewards of your gifts. We come now this morning with an offering and return those gifts back to you. We ask that you bless these gifts so that they may grow your kingdom today. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Now, oh, if there are any children, they can come on down to the front. You guys may be seated. Good morning, friends. Good morning. I am so glad to see you all this morning. Okay, everybody ready? Crisscross, hands in the nest. Listening ears on. All right, Today, we're going to talk about something very important that God asks us to do. And we're going to start by taking a look at our bulletin. And you got your counting fingers ready for me this morning? We're going to count how many times that we've already done this and how many times we're going to do this in the service today with the adults. And what I'm talking about is prayer. It's really important. And God asks us to do this. That's how we talk to Him. So let's look in our bulletin. Let's look right here. You see this word, invocation? That means prayer. That's one, so that count that one. One. And, oh, this one right here, offertory prayer. That's two, so count up two. And, oh, look, we sang about prayer right here, so go ahead and count that one, too. Three. Oh, look, prayers for the people. Four. Oh, and we're going to say another one here in the children's story. Five. Let's look on the back side here. After we leave, let's see if they're going to do it again. Mr. Curtis is going to talk in the message, and you know, I've heard him say prayers, so let's go ahead and count that one. How many are we up to? Six times already? Oh, we're not even done. Oh, look right here. Benediction, that's another word for prayer. How many? Seven times that we're going to say prayers in our service today? Wow, that's pretty cool. We're going to talk to God seven times as a group today. You know, audience participation is approaching. Warning. You know, prayer is so important that there is even a special prayer in the Bible that God taught us to pray. And before we leave today, we're going to say that prayer. And I want you to listen with your listening ears and with your heads bowed and your eyes closed. And I want you to listen as all of these grown-ups participate in that prayer with us together. And you know what? They already know what it is. And you guys are going to start learning it in children's worship today. Okay? You guys ready? Okay. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from
thank you. Wasn't that a wonderful prayer? Jesus gave us those words, and we can pray to Him anytime. And today in children's worship, we're going to talk some more about prayer. Okay? So if you're going with me, let's head over to the door.
Unruly bunch, those kids. Much like these youth, didn't expect to see you today, but as I heard it, they were on their retreat, and the water system goes out, and the youth took a vote and decided they weren't going to spend another night with Michael Furr if he couldn't shower. So they had to come back early and adjusted and made it through and wrapped up things at their house. So glad you guys made it through, but it is good to see you. Glad you're here. I know you're tired. Been a long weekend. Hopefully a good one. Good morning. Worth the wait, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. Worth the wait. That was gorgeous. It's so much fun. On Monday morning, you speak a name of a song into the ether when it's your turn to do that, like it is mine. And Billy Ralph says, "See what I can do," and then that's what happens. Thank you, talented and gifted and willing people. Beautiful, very much. What else do I have? More somber news? Well, not really. Somber in celebration. Ann Goodman passed. Her fight with cancer is over, and she is home. And arrangements are still being arranged. So hear something in the next couple days you should hear. If you don't, give us a call. But please remember her family as we pray together. Yes, as we pray together. It seemed like when she started counting, I felt a little self-conscious, like maybe we should cut one or two. You guys, what do you think? Yeah. Well, it's a little weird. I don't know. Anyway, maybe not. What do you come bearing today that you could lift up? A prayer you can make. I hope you pray on your own. Hope you pray before bed when you arise. Hope you pray as needed. Hope you pray often. Today we do it together. It is different, and that's okay. So in a minute I'm going to ask you to lift up what you brought that you'd like to lay at the foot of the cross, at the throne of a king who listens and is interested. You can repeat ones we've already talked about. That's okay. You can say something that only you and God know what it means. He won't be surprised. And after we all, or some of us share, I'll close. Will you pray with me?
Alan Hayes. Kathy Holly. Charles Parker. The clients of the Christian Outreach Center.
Father, so close together, I can't help but notice and recognize the difference between a room full of your followers and the rumble it makes when we pray together the Lord's Prayer and the single voice among them that speaks something personal to you. Convince us again, Father, that they sound the same to you. Or regardless of how they sound, they garner the same attention. I can conceive, Father, not of how you hear without being frustrated, listen and care without growing weary. But thank you. From our petty concerns to those that drown us and overwhelm us with emotion and hurt and fear, we ask you to be present. Throw your arms around a grieving family and friends. Give wisdom to those facing decisions, choices about futures. Give patience to those waiting, endurance to those who don't feel like they have another step in them. Give yourself to us, Father. Give us your strength. And use us from this corner to all of them. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Will you please stand for the reading of today's gospel lesson?
Today's lesson comes from Matthew 25, 1 through 13. And if you're following along in the Church Pew Bible, that is page 806, and it rolls over into 807. The Parable of the 10 Bridesmaids. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout. Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him. Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise replied, no, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves. And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he replied, truly, I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Yeah.
here. We can do what we want. Who said that? You're telling? Yeah, I bet you will. Yeah, I'm telling. I had all these Roy jokes and fur jokes ready, and now you're here ruining everything. I'll just stay focused today. Stay focused. Thank you, by the way, for that. I drive from Wilkesboro to Boone when I come here on a regular basis, a few times a week. I have time to ponder things, which is good for some, bad for others. One of the things I ponder occasionally when I'm whatever is the folks who traveled that way before 421 was there. Raise your hand if you had a four-lane 421 this century bumper sticker. Anybody? Raise your hand if you remember them. Yes, yes, you remember them. That beautiful four-lane highway has not always been there, children. I can remember, I think it was finished right after my senior year at Carson Newman, I think. I can't remember. Get with me later, those of you who actually know the year it was completed. But I can remember driving that road, and it was just a crazy, icy two-lane road snaking up the mountain. I can't remember it when it was old, old 421, but I wonder what that was like. I can't remember it before that when it was a dirt path. I can imagine what that was like during a gully washer, like we've had a couple of those this past summer. What was it like when it was just a dusty trail? And not enough of a trail to be dusty. And then when there was just a path, and keep going back with me, I go back to those folks who settled this gorgeous part of the country. And when they filled up the lowlands, they came up here looking for something different. And I can imagine bushwhacking through the rhododendron, the mountain laurel, around the getting hands pricked by the black locust trees and all this. And they finally get to the top of the Blue Ridge. And they can tell they've found something. And they get up there, and what are they rewarded with? Hills and hills with old grandfather peeking at them, saying, "You're almost there." And they've been promised this beautiful valley, this expansive plain where they can raise livestock and grow crops. And all they see is hills and hills and treetops. And they keep going. They find a river valley to follow, and that helps them get through a little bit. And just horizon after horizon. And it's the first time. They don't have an atlas. They don't have a map. They certainly don't have a, I don't know how to get anywhere. You know that? I used to be a map guy. And now I just plug it in, and here we go. And then I get there, and how'd you get here? I'm just this thing right here. Left when it said left. And occasionally that gets you in trouble, but for the most part it works, and it's great. It's all about that destination. All about that destination, right? Right? Few things, and there are some things, but few things entice us like a good destination. All right? Just buckle up. Go with me here. See if you think I agree. Now, this is not your garden variety stop and smell the roses along the journey. That's not where we're going. So don't, if you think that, gotcha. Few things entice us more than a destination. So maybe you think you've arrived when blank. You ready? You've arrived when you, students, you make the dean's list. Is that kind of, well, next semester starts pretty quick, doesn't it? You've arrived. Maybe when you get that diploma, you will have arrived. Maybe. Well, oh, no, wait, here's another one. When you get that job, now you're home. You are, maybe. Maybe. Oh, when you meet the right person. You meet that person. Then you have arrived. Or you finish that house, or buy that house, as it were, or move to that town. I am it. I have arrived. Am I getting closer? Wiser folks who've done, okay, let me keep going. We just celebrated, is that the right word? We celebrated Veterans Day, and we honor our veterans and their service. Thank you for yours, those of you who are here. Military and the war machine is very regimented most of the time, right? And there are clear objectives, clear goals. So think about that. You've arrived when you've held that wall or defended that city or won that war. And there always seems to be another one, doesn't there? Or maybe later on, when you've made enough money, now you've arrived. And relatedly, when you reach retirement. There you go. My dad loves retirement. He loves that he has it and I don't, mostly, but he loves retirement. Seems to be having a good time. Maybe. So of all these departures and these arrivals, these destinations, think of it. Think of it like that big board. They still have this, I think, for now. Although last time I flew, I actually used my phone and I ignored I got the app from Delta. And I ignored the big board, but the departure and arrival board, right? You know when you're leaving, and you know approximately when you're arriving, right? You with me? Can you see that board in your mind's eye at the airport? Where do you want to go? Start at Anchorage and go down. Where do you want to go? Where are you headed? And when yours doesn't show up, you panic. Where am I going? It's okay to do that. Let me shift gears. It's okay. Life can be measurable. We like it that way. We like to, this is today, this is tomorrow, this is what I'm doing, these are the steps I'm taking. And that's, goals are good, right? I think so. But what about arrival? Do we ever arrive? Do we do the same thing with our faith? We could have a fun debate. Is baptism an arrival or a departure? Is it a destination? Is it a big, what is it? That's another day. We can have it, though. Maybe it's both. Other traditions have First Communion, very formally. It's something that's celebrated, a coming of age in faith. Maybe when you've risen to church leadership, there you go. Maybe even join the choir. These folks have arrived. Look, they get to wear these costumes every Sunday. I mean, they are it. They are it. They have arrived. I know, Billy Rowe. Stay in your lane, Curtis. Stay in your lane. Okay, I got it. But when do you arrive in your faith? When? When you get good enough, right? That's what it comes down to. When I do enough things good enough. There's a Ten Commandments, right? Four or five of those I can check off. I have not killed anybody ever. I am good to go. There's this used car I'm driving by. It's on my road, and I'm not going to tell you what it is because I'll be embarrassed. But I'm driving by it every day now. It's for sale, and I want it. I don't need it. Don't need a new car. The mighty Buick is rolling on. But, boy, this one's cooler. Not a lot. Just enough. So maybe coveting I'm struggling with a little bit. But when we get good enough, then we've arrived. Right? I mean, Jesus lays it all out here in this very clear, very understandable parable. What he expects of us. All right. Chapter 25, back to basics. Chapter 25 is one long warning against the seduction of destinations. One long warning. And we only got a third of chapter 25. And that's the allure of the invitations. The bridesmaids, it's the party of the year. This is a wedding bash we cut out a couple hours on a Saturday to come to a wedding and have a great time and throw rice. You know, one kid didn't untie the rice bag and hit me in the face with it. That was fun. That was great. I'm trying to see if anybody here knows who it was. Nobody's admitted it yet. Okay, anyway. For these folks, people didn't get together like we get together. They didn't have 421 this century or any other century. So it was a celebration that you and I can't relate to exactly. So this is ripped from the headlines, as it were. This story that Jesus is telling is relatable. Be ready. When's the bridegroom coming? I don't know. He's walking 40 miles to get here. Be ready when he gets here. And why'd they lock him out? Well, that's a story for another day. But be ready, he's saying. But don't just because you got the invitation, you haven't arrived. And the next one, the familiar one, story of the talents. Right? Three guys are given talents. One buries it. Two use it. And grow it, right? Master comes back, give me my stuff. First guy says, here it is, there's more of it. Good for you. Second guy, here's a little more of it. Good for you. Next guy, this is so precious, I buried it in the yard right beside my dog's favorite bone, and I have kept it safe for you, and here it is. Awkward silence. Hoarding of a blessing is no good, we're told. Don't hoard it, don't keep. Don't hold too tightly to things that were given to you. And the next one, the peril of the pious, right? Sitting on your holy rock over there, The sheep and the goats, you know this story? At the end of the day, when I come back, I'm going to separate sheep and goats. Which one are you? Well, did you feed the hungry? Did you give water to the thirsty? You're in the good pile. If you're not, you're over here. Do I have to feed everybody who's hungry? Everybody who's thirsty, give them a drink? Is Gatorade okay? Jesus, what are you saying? See, Jesus is answering the question, okay, Jesus, you're going away. You're going to die, and I think I'm starting to understand that. And then you're going to come back, but not really, because then you're going away again. But then one day you're coming back, right? So how do I know when that is? How do I get ready? What do I do in the meantime? The disciples are pushing and poking. Jesus, just give me a list. I like lists. Tell me what to do. And Jesus says, I'm going to clear all that up for you. Just listen to these three parables. Is it clear for you? Tom, is it clear for you? It is? I think you're just nodding because you thought you were supposed to, but that's okay. The disciples want to know what's the end game. And even those who are just sitting around listening to Jesus, they want to know, how does this end? Another example, when Jesus is asked, what's the key to this? Mark chapter 10, the rich young ruler, a familiar story to most of us. This fellow comes up to Jesus and he says, I've heard about you. I want to tell me what to do to inherit eternal life. And Jesus says, well, follow the commandments. I'm interpreting a little bit here. And he interrupts him and says, yeah, I got all that. I got all that. Honor thy father and mother, the whole 10. I had a couple more because I'm just really good at this stuff. I got all that. What do I do? Jesus peers into him as only he can do and knows who he is and says, you're very rich. You've done well. Good for you. Sell it all, then you can follow me. Well, so that now I know that's the answer. Give everything away. Give it all away. Coats and ties, wouldn't that be great? Anyway, give it all away. Give it all away. That's the key. That's what Jesus is saying. We should all give everything. Just pass it around so nobody... That doesn't make sense. He gets away from that. The disciples say, Jesus, but seriously, we've given up everything to follow you. How does this work? If you have even a dollar, you can't get into heaven. So Jesus decides to clear it up very quickly. He wants his disciples to be informed, wants them to understand. He says, take a camel, shove it through the eye of a needle. That's how it works. Puzzled looks. Peter says, look, and look it up in Mark 10. He says, look, we have given up everything to follow you. We want to be here. What's the end game? What happens next? And Jesus takes a deep breath in my mind's eye, lets his frustration settle, and says, all of you who have given up so much, you will be repaid 100-fold. And they start to go, oh, okay, that's better. And he can't help himself, and he has to throw in, and you know it. But the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. And then they're like, what? We just thought we were getting somewhere. I thought I knew where you were taking me. I thought I knew what to do, what steps to take, what... Jesus, this reminds me in a loose way about a hike that I took with my family a couple years ago on our first trip back to Montana to visit. Kids were old enough to go. Sarah was there. My dad was there. We're some friends from there. We're going to go to Bear Creek Overlook. Beautiful, beautiful spot in the Bitterroot Mountains. Been there a couple times. Loved it. Wanted to go back. Wanted to share it with my kids. Looked it up, said, you know, it's about 3 miles round trip, no big deal. It's an overlook, though, so you have to go up to get there. They wind the entire time. And it's switchbacks, what makes it built-in corners, built-in transitions. Oh, now we're turning big. How many more? And that was Sarah, that's what she said. My dad, bless his heart, he's the worst. Well, I'm too old for this. He complained before we left the house about he's too old for it, but he wasn't going to not go all the way up. And I may have messed up. Maybe it was three miles one way. But half of it's downhill, you understand. It's not that big a deal. But I keep saying, just wait. It's beautiful. The snow is still on the mountains to the west. It's gorgeous. Oh, it's the most beautiful view. Oh, and they're just, where are the snacks? My water, I don't, I just, oh. Just, I think I carried some of them part of the way. I don't know. It was miserable. But we got to the top. We went, walk out on this escarpment. Lovely mountain word, escarpment. Walk out there, and it's just, oh, the majesty of the Lord is all around us. And they came and they hugged me and said, Dad, it was all, no, they didn't. No, they didn't. No, they didn't. Can we go now? They complained all the way down the mountain, all the way back. And to this day, or the rest of that trip, it was a joke. I'd say, hey, let's go to Waffle House. It's just around the corner. Is it really, Dad? How many miles is it? It's still a joke. It's a really good one. I enjoy it a lot. False destinations will mess you up. When you don't know what's coming and the journey's all you've got, man, you can get frustrated. You can downright disgusted with the one who brung you, as we say in my home country. When you don't know. And the disciples, they just want to know what is coming. And Jesus refuses. He steadfastly refuses to put a mark, an X marks the spot on that proverbial map of life. He will not do it. Why? Why? Don't you want it? Students, what's next? Just tell me. Good luck. He didn't tell me either. You just got to figure it out. You just got to listen. Doesn't get any better, does it, there? More wise ones. What's next? But Jesus won't do it. He's asked over. Go back and read the Gospels. He has asked so many times, and every time he just messes with people. Kingdom of heaven like this, sheep and goats, which one you want to be? And he sets these incredibly high standards of perfection that nobody can reach. And then we sit in our pews and go, that's right, preacher. Be perfect. Like God is perfect. That's what I'm going to do next week. And we nod like Tom because we think we're supposed to. No, I'm picking on you, of course. The earliest Christians were called, among other things, followers of the way. Most think it came from the whole way, truth, life thing. Pretty good. The followers of the way. Expecting any day now for Jesus to come back triumphantly. But in the meantime, they were following the way. Think back to our poor pioneers. They're coming up and they're plotting. They probably had bumper stickers on their wagons, right? Four lane, 421 this century, you know. On the back of their mule, right on his rump, four lane, 421. They're just making their way. They get to that last horizon. Well, then it's not really a lot. But finally they do. Finally they do. Wherever it is, Cumberland Gap, however far you can. You know, you've seen it. You've hit those vistas. And you see it, and the Tennessee River Valley is out ahead of you. And there's always one in the back. I mean, they've made it. People have died on this journey. They are ready to plant their flag and raise their family, and their community will grow. And there's always one guy in the back, probably named Curtis, and he says, I wonder what's on the other side of that. And they have no idea that it's the Mississippi River. And beyond that, we're just getting started. They have no clue, but all they can see is what's right in front of them, just like me and just like you. I want to know. I want to know that destination. Jesus comes out and he says, I believe. When he's asked again and again, Jesus, what? Give me a list. What do I do? How do I do this? I want eternal life. I want to live forever. I want to do it right. How do I do it? How do I do it? And he says, come take a walk with me. No. Just tell me what to do. You said you're going away. I don't know when. Seems like soon. Things are happening. How do I find you? How am I ready? You say be ready. I want to be ready. How do I do that? Just come take a walk. I don't want to take a walk with you. Just tell me. And And he sits down and he says, take a walk with me. And then the disciples say, oh, take a walk with me. One that leads up and down tragedy and victory. One that wanders around confusion to success, bypasses happiness for achievement and circles back. Take a walk with me. Take a walk with me. How long is this walk? Don't ask me that. Take a walk with me. And we write hymns about it, and they're beautiful, aren't they? Should I sing it? I'm just kidding, BR. I'm going to stay in my lane. Take a walk with me. And refuse any temptation to mark a destination. And your walk with Jesus that you're invited on, that you're called to, that is required of you, refuse any temptation to mark a destination. Refuse it. Because we never, ever arrive. Will you pray with me? Father, I will fail today at this mandate because I see with my eyes and I am limited by the direction my head turns, and I will fail today and set a destination and measure myself against it foolishly. Protect me from that. Give me the wisdom to be prepared, whatever that looks like. Give me the wisdom to not hoard what you've given me and use it for you, whatever that looks like. And give me the humility to serve others, no matter what they look like. And maybe that will be a good start. Because I still want that list, Father. I still want it. I can yap about it all day long on Sunday morning, but I confess I still want to know what you want from me. I want it to be simple. But I am convinced it's not. I am convinced that you don't need a walk with me any more than I need a hole in the head, but you want one. And I need it desperately. And I ask you to take my hand and hold it tightly, because I will pull away and I will wander. I am not naive enough to think I will enjoy every bit of the journey, but show me where to go and meet me at the end. Or better yet, take a walk with me wherever you go. Father, we thank you for this gift, this Jesus who saves us and challenges us and calls us. Give us the strength to follow and the courage to keep up. It's in his name we pray. Amen. In a minute, I'm going to ask you to stand and sing hymn 293. If you have a decision, if you've been thinking about making this your church home and you'd like to make that public today or anything else, if you want to come up and just be somewhere, there is power in movement. There's power in being still sometimes too, but there is power in movement. If you want to sit where you are and respond, if you just want to enjoy a beautiful hymn, I invite you to respond as you will, as you have been led. But let's stand and sing together. Grace and peace. Have a good afternoon.